Good evening. My name is Soledad Hurst, and I am very delighted to be welcoming you here this evening for the first of the Hurst Lecture Series events for 2016. When my husband Bob and I endowed this series about 4 years ago, it was with the goal to support the Aspen Institute in bringing brilliant minds to the Aspen community. And we have two such brilliant minds here with us this evening. We are very excited to welcome Ambassador Robert Hutchings and Professor Jeremi Suri. Let me first introduce Ambassador Hutchings. Robert Hutchings is a professor of public affairs at the Lyndon B. Johnson School of Public Affairs at the University of Texas at Austin, it's a mouthful, where he holds the Walt and Elspeth Rostow Chair in National Security. He served as dean at the LBJ School from 2010 to 2015. Before his positions at University of Texas, he was a diplomat in residence in the Woodrow Wilson School of Public and International Affairs at Princeton University. And while he was there, he also served as, I can hear that echo a little bit. He served as assistant dean of the school and as faculty chair of its Master in Public Policy program. Ambassador Hutchings has served as chairman in the U.S. National Intelligence Council in Washington. His academic and diplomatic career has included several important roles, including special advisor to the Secretary of State with the rank of ambassador. He's been a recipient of the National Intelligence Medal and the U.S. State Department Superior Honor Award. In addition, he was also awarded the Order of Merit with Commander's Cross of the Republic of Poland for his contributions to Polish freedom. He is a graduate of the United States Naval Academy and received his PhD from the University of Virginia. And now to Professor Jeremi Suri. He holds the Mack Brown Distinguished Chair for Leadership in Global Affairs at the University of Texas at Austin. He has a joint appointment in, one, the Lyndon B. Johnson School of Public Affairs, and two, the Department of History. Professor Suri is the author and editor of seven books, including the widely acclaimed biography of one of America's most distinguished diplomats, the book called Henry Kissinger and the American Century. He has published frequently in the New York Times, Foreign Affairs, Boston Globe, Wired Magazine, Politico, and other publications. Professor Suri has received numerous awards for his research and teaching. The Princeton Review, for example, has named him one of the top 300 professors in the United States. He's earned his BA in history from Stanford University, an MA in history from Ohio University, and then earned his PhD from Yale University in 2001. Professor Suri blogs on foreign policy and contemporary politics. His research interests include many topics, including the formation and spread of nation states, the connections between foreign policy and domestic politics, international security, protest and dissident movements, and globalization. Ambassador Hutchings and Dr. Suri have compiled and edited this book here, Foreign Policy Breakthroughs, Cases and Successful Diplomacy, and after the discussion, it will be in sale in the lobby, and they will both be present to sign it for you if you're interested. Please join me in welcoming Ambassador Hutchings and Dr. Suri.
Room looks different from this side here.
Hey, can you hear me all right? Wonderful, thank you. Well, thank you very much for that kind introduction and the invitation to come here. It's a real pleasure to be here before such a distinguished audience. It's always fun to share a podium with my friend and colleague, Jeremi Suri, and we love talking about this book, so I hope you'll indulge us for a while as we talk about this book. Let me say a few words about what brought us to this project in the first place. The world is experiencing the greatest flux in at least 60 years. It's a more complicated world, not always a more dangerous world, but certainly a more complicated world than we've lived through. Yet, at the very time that we need more strategic responses to these strategic challenges we face, there seems to be a deficit in strategic action all around the world. For our country, our military is unrivaled around the world. We have the most capable, most experienced, most best-trained military the world has ever seen. The same is not true for our diplomatic corps. Our diplomatic corps has tended to be underfunded and, frankly, underprepared for the challenges we face around the world. So these were some of the issues that drew us to this project. Another dimension of this is because our Cold War experience compelled us to have a military response to a lot of foreign policy challenges, we tended to carry over to this new and very different era a kind of default position that we look for a military response to challenges that don't really lend themselves to a military solution. We've seen this with in the greater Middle East in the last few years. I don't need to go into that in too much depth. I would say it's not just the United States that suffers this deficit in diplomatic training and study. It's other countries as well. So our goal in a project we've modestly called Reinventing Diplomacy is to make the study of diplomacy more modern, more comprehensive, more global in scope, and better informed by history. Let me dwell on the more global in scope a moment. It's a strange irony, really, that diplomats from different countries are trained in very different ways. Even American and Mexican or French and German diplomats, neighboring countries, train their diplomats very differently. And this shows up in miscommunication at the diplomatic level. So we've done a couple of things, more than a couple, to try to make a contribution to the study and practice of diplomacy. We have created new courses at the University of Texas. Jeremi and I have co-taught two of them, one undergraduate, one graduate. We created something called the Austin Forum on Diplomacy and Statecraft. Every January, at least every January for 2 years so far, we have brought to Austin, in at a very nice time of the year to be in Austin, about two dozen diplomats from the United States, Europe, and Latin America for 3 days in what we bill as an Aspen-like experience. I hope you don't mind our borrowing the term. Maybe Aspen a little more modest in scope, but it was really the same idea, to bring people together outside the Washington Beltway, outside what they call the Brussels bubble, outside their professional inbox, into an environment where they can safely speak to one another off the record. And it's turned out to be a wonderful experience, which we intend to keep going for as long as we can possibly keep it going. The other contribution we've made is the book that we'll be talking about in a moment. And I won't dwell too much on how we came about this, but Jeremi and I settled fairly early on the idea of doing case studies, because the case study literature has been neglected in recent years. And we decided we wanted to do cases in successful diplomacy. Scholars in particular love to revel in diplomatic failure and point the finger and have a lot of fun doing it. We concluded that people ought to recognize success and learn from success as well. So we commissioned seven other scholars. We contributed each a chapter ourselves, and we'll talk about those in some detail later on. So we assembled a group, an international group of scholars, some with policymaking experience, others really just academics, invited them to contribute chapters on some topics that I'll talk about in a few moments, and then we let them go and write the stories of their cases as they saw fit and as the evidence took them, and then we tried to draw some general lessons out of these very disparate nine separate case studies. And part of the goal was to illuminate what diplomacy really means.
If you want to take it. Absolutely. So first of all, I want to thank my colleague and friend, Bob Hutchings. We've been talking about this book in multiple places, the State Department, the Wilson Center, and elsewhere, but we've been most excited to come here. This is the penultimate moment, because this is when we're actually going to get our ideas into the Aspen blood veins, right? And that's what's most important. We had a wonderful discussion this morning, and I even see a number of people from this morning have come back, repeat offenders. What we talked about this morning, and that I want to come back to, building on what Bob said, is this question of what diplomacy is. A large part of the book, where we put a lot of work, was really trying to understand the concept of diplomacy, which is a concept that as Americans we haven't spent much time thinking about. In fact, we've spent the last century trashing the idea of diplomacy, which is to say we spend a lot of time talking about markets. We know what markets are. We spend a lot of time talking about what war is. We know what war is. But have we really understood what it means to be a successful diplomat? What are the qualities? What are the elements that make someone a diplomat? And I fear, and we make this point in the book, that one of the problems we've confronted is actually a long historical problem, which is that those with much power often feel little need for diplomacy. There's the tendency to think that power compensates for the skills required to politically work with those who are different. And in fact, our founders predicted this problem. If you read Jefferson, if you read Madison, one of the points they make is that as our small republic becomes larger, we must remember the virtues of being a small republic. And one of those main virtues was the strategic and thoughtful approach to the work and management with people in other societies, from American Indians through the British and the French and various other groups. We haven't, over the last century, spent a lot of time thinking about what diplomacy is. And many of us who even claim to be diplomatic historians, if you look at what diplomatic history has become, it's largely the story of everything other than diplomacy, in fact. Things from elections to cultural affairs to war and peace, not issues that are unimportant, but not the actual work of diplomacy itself. In our book, we make a number of points that I think are worthy of stressing here about what diplomacy is. Diplomacy is not telling people what to do and waiting for them to do it. Diplomacy is about beginning with the recognition that even a weaker actor has a vote, and that the weaker actor must be understood. Empathy, understanding, respect are at the basis of diplomacy. Diplomacy also involves a commitment to negotiation, a commitment to work with those who are different. American universalism often leads us to presume that a homogeneous world is necessary for effective political action, when in fact, our argument is actually the heterogeneity of the world is actually the source of diplomatic opportunity. And I would argue that, especially before the last century, the greatest American successes were working in a heterogeneous world and taking advantage of the opportunities we had to work with multiple different kinds of actors who could not work with each other. But what's happened in the last century is we've forgotten the importance of that heterogeneity. Compromise, relationship building, but most of all, if there's one point we really emphasize above all in this book, diplomacy is the recognition that everyone must gain from an international agreement or an international action, whatever it may be. There cannot be winners and losers. There must be winners and winners. Some will win more than others, but there must be winners and winners. And the most effective diplomats, we argue, and we'll talk a bit more about this, are diplomats who recognize that. One of the challenges is our political culture wants winners and losers. But the reality of policymaking requires mutual gains, requires winners and winners. And part of the struggle is figuring out how to work that into our system. We argue that fundamentally, the story that we are looking at is not the story of outcomes alone, but of processes, of the actions individuals take to engage other societies. This seems simple, but it's actually quite rare. The willingness, the desire to meet with and work with someone who you dislike, who you disagree with, who you barely understand, but wish to work with, rather than to convert or to ignore or to destroy. The converting, the ignoring, and destroying is more of what we do than the actual working with. Our argument is that diplomacy, this activity is an art, and it's an art that needs more attention. It's something we don't teach. It's something we don't talk about. It's something we don't have space for in our rhetoric as a society, and in fact, all of what we do pushes against it. In our book, what we're trying to do is, in a sense, resuscitate an understanding of what that means, provide a vocabulary for that. If our book succeeds, we no longer accept the notion that to be a powerful country means there are people we shouldn't talk to because we don't like them. Nor do we ask ourselves, is it worth talking to someone? Of course, you talk to other individuals. If our book succeeds, people recognize that foreign policy is not about power, nor about interests alone, but about relationships. Our argument is that the most successful diplomats are the diplomats who manage relationships with the most important actors, many of whom they dislike, manage those relationships, and manage them to the greatest benefit of all the participants in those relationships. That's what diplomacy is, as we see it. We argue this is something not only that we need to study and talk about, but something we need to start teaching as well. And I said this morning, I promised I wouldn't repeat myself, but I will on this point. I sometimes fear, as I look out at my 300 undergraduates who I have on Tuesday and Thursday mornings, I sometimes fear we're teaching them to be morally self-righteous, to be technically capable, but not to be diplomatic. In fact, just the opposite. If we teach them to make a lot of money in economic markets, but not to learn foreign languages and not to work with different kinds of people, are we really encouraging the right behaviors? And that's a deeper question I think we need to ask ourselves. Diplomacy for us is the commitment to working with, managing, and understanding relationships with people so different from ourselves, and putting that front and center in foreign policy. Our book has a number of cases where we talk about this. We kind of philosophize in the introduction, and then the book is an effort to really dig down and show what that means in practice. And Bob is going to give an overview of the different cases, and then we'll dig deep into the two that we wrote.
Thanks, Jeremi. We deliberately chose authors and subjects that were quite different. So some of the cases deal with massive issues. My chapter on the end of the Cold War was a very big one. But some dealt with the convening of a single conference. Some cases involved the United States. Others didn't have the U.S. involved at all. Some were written by Americans, others by non-Americans. We didn't give instructions on the kinds of conclusions we were looking for. We really wanted the conclusions that we drew at the end of this study to grow out of the cases themselves. As you'll see in several of the cases, our understanding of diplomacy is not the absence of force. Often force and diplomacy go hand in hand. I spent a good deal of my career as a diplomat. In fact, all my gray hair came from negotiating with the Russians.
I thought it was from faculty.
Faculty made it turn white, yeah. Diplomacy does include an element of force and coercion. The use of economic sanctions and other pressure points are part of diplomacy, but those instruments alone don't constitute successful diplomacy. So let me describe each of the chapters fairly briefly. I'll just pull out some highlights, not so much that you don't want to read the book, but enough to tease you into maybe wanting to read these chapters. Each chapter is about 25 pages, well-researched. These are deep dives into history by authors, most of whom have written entire books on the same subject matter, so they know their stuff very well. The first one, and they span the period from the immediate post-World War II era into the 21st century. So actually, we arranged them chronologically. The first case was the United Nations Relief and Rehabilitation Administration, a very little known entity, but it was the largest intergovernmental relief organization ever mounted to provide relief for and humanitarian aid to refugees right after World War II. The two most interesting dimensions of this to me, in my reading of the chapter, are the prior planning for this began as early as 1940. The British were stockpiling food supplies for post-war relief already in 1940. It's an almost unbelievable exercise in foresight. The Roosevelt administration of the United States created a separate office headed by Dean Acheson, then an assistant secretary, 3 months before Pearl Harbor to plan for the same thing. They never could have pulled this off had they waited till the war end and said, oops, we've got to do something about refugees. So it's this prior planning that is very hard to come by in the world we live in now of a 24-hour news cycle. The second dimension was the extent to which Roosevelt and his administration learned from history. In particular, they learned from the history of U.S. efforts to provide humanitarian relief after World War I to war-ravaged Russia under the Bolsheviks. We did so without the involvement of the government of Russia, and it created huge resentment and failure, really, to deliver aid effectively because the host government wasn't involved. So the Roosevelt administration successfully brought the Soviet Union and China into the planning process. The second case was the convening of the Bandung Conference in 1955, Bandung, Indonesia. It was the birthplace of what later became known as the Third World or the Non-Aligned Movement. It was, looking at it from a certain perspective, it was a mixed result. Not much came out of the conference, but it did provide leaders of newly liberated post-colonial states, very weak governments, and untested leaders an opportunity to have a voice in international affairs, a voice that was distinct from the first world of the Western Alliance and the second world, the communist bloc. So to that extent, it launched the Non-Aligned Movement. The third case, and I dwell on this one, is a really interesting one. It was the successful conclusion of the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty that went into effect in 1970. The treaty was actually signed in 1968, and the negotiations began already under John Kennedy in 1963. It's interesting in that the assessment of the Kennedy administration and most outside scholars in 1963 was that we were headed for an explosion of new nuclear powers. 25 to 30 new nuclear powers were going to populate the world. Since then, with the successful conclusion of the treaty, 4 new nuclear powers have come about. I suppose we wish it had been no new nuclear powers, but 4 is a lot better than 25. So it's really as a time when we are worrying, appropriately enough, about Iran's nuclear program and North Korea's, it's worth recalling that we could be in a much more proliferated world than we are in had it not been for this conference. One of the interesting features of it was that the negotiations were done in secret in Geneva, behind closed doors, with experts methodically over the course of years working through the issues that divided these very disparate actors from the United States and the Soviet Union through much smaller countries around the world. There's a lesson here that was applied to the Iran nuclear negotiations. And one of the lessons is there is room and need for secrecy in successful diplomacy. The negotiations, had they been subjected to the glare of public scrutiny, never would have gotten started. Of course, once the negotiations are getting nearing completion, then they have to be presented to the public for their approval and to the U.S. Congress for approval, but the negotiations would not have gotten as far as they did without having this forum in Geneva that allowed for the breakthrough to occur. The next case is Jeremi's case on the American opening to China under Nixon and Kissinger. He'll talk about that in a few minutes. The case after that is the Camp David Accord between Egypt and Israel. It's a fairly well-known case, but this case was written by an Israeli scholar from the perspective of Israel and Egypt. And I think this gave, for me at least, a new take on a well-told story from the American side. A couple of interesting points here. One was that the three parties to the agreement, Jimmy Carter playing the role of mediator, Menachem Begin, the Israeli prime minister, and Anwar Sadat, the Egyptian president, had three very different set of objectives. Carter, for political reasons as well as personal religious convictions, wanted to see the creation of a Palestinian state. The Israeli prime minister, Menachem Begin, wanted to pursue a separate peace with Egypt to prevent the emergence of a Palestinian state. And Anwar Sadat didn't want either of those things. He wanted to recover lost territory. And as one of you pointed out in our commentary this morning, he also wanted U.S. development assistance because he had just broken away from the Soviet Union. So here we had three players, three actors with almost antithetical objectives who nonetheless forged a peace that has lasted for 40 years. And as bad as things are in the Middle East, they would be even worse if they weren't buttressed by this enduring peace between Egypt and Israel, for which, I might add, we have paid a lot of money over the years. The second dimension was, again, the virtue of secrecy. Talks were held in Camp David at the presidential retreat in Camp David, Maryland, away from the glare of the media. No media were involved at all. There was no communication with the media outside the compound. The two parties, with Carter and the Americans mediating, simply worked through their differences as they went through the process. As they came out, there was great attention to selling a very controversial deal domestically back in Israel and Egypt. And here's where the artful use of creative ambiguity played a role. There were some issues, there were and are the same issues, that are too hard to resolve. One is the status of Jerusalem. The other is the status of the so-called occupied territories. So the artful solution was to refer to these terms, these issues, in ways that could be portrayed differently by the Israelis and the Egyptians to their own publics. Otherwise, they would have had to declare that they'd failed to deliver to their own audiences. On the question of occupied territories, they simply referred to occupied territories without specifying which they were, because if they specified which territories, the agreement would have broken down. And both sides understood that the other side needed to go back home to portray this as a successful outcome from the other side's perspective. Just to anticipate the current set of issues, the Iran nuclear deal, we should want, or we should understand at least, that the Iranian negotiators have to go back to Iran. They also have domestic stakeholders and domestic constituencies. They have to be able to portray this as a success for Iran. And this shouldn't offend us too much. We should want them to be able to go back and portray this as a success. Otherwise, the deal collapses. And frankly, we should want the deal to be of satisfaction to the other side. You don't get a deal if only one side wins, as Jeremi pointed out in his comments about diplomacy. The next chapter is mine on the American diplomacy and the end of the Cold War. I'll talk about that a little later. The next case after that was a long look at the evolution of the European community / European Union. There have been shelves and shelves of books written about this. This was written by a British scholar who actually is on the faculty of a Berlin university. So it's told really from the perspective of an insider and a lawyer. And he tells the story in two parts. One was the story of how Europe became a community of law, not through the actions of luminary political leaders like Jean Monnet and Robert Schuman and the heroes of European unity, but by unnamed European magistrates making individual decisions in European court cases that established the primacy of European law over German law or French law, case by case by case, building up what is now a European body of law. The second half of his chapter is on a case that I understand very well, was the enlargement of the European Union eastward into Eastern Europe, the former communist countries. And here he points out that once the decision had been taken at the political level that countries in this region that met certain political and economic criteria, known as the acquis communautaire, would then be invited to join. And there were a very long list of requirements to join. Once the political decision had been made, the implementation of the decision was turned over to nameless Brussels-based bureaucrats. And these Brussels-based bureaucrats began to exercise authority that even political leaders didn't have. So later, when the French, for political reasons, wanted to slow down, if not block altogether, the accession of Bulgaria, they were unable to do so because the European Commission in Brussels was able to say, these are the criteria that were laid out by political leaders in summit meetings. These are the conditions that the Bulgarians have met. They're in. So it's an interesting way of seeing how this, you know, world-changing evolution of the European Union was done in large part by nameless administrators. The next case is on the North American Free Trade Agreement, but it was done by two Mexican scholars, one of whom had actually been a participant in the negotiations. So it was a very interesting tale of how Mexico negotiated this agreement with its much more powerful northern neighbor. And one of the devices used was what is called in the political science literature two-level games. It comes out of the literature of trade negotiations in which trade negotiators and governments negotiate on two levels. Obviously, they're negotiating internationally to reach an agreement, but they're also negotiating domestically to satisfy the California farm lobby and many other domestic interests who could block the agreement if it's not to their satisfaction. And these two levels operate simultaneously, not sequentially. It's not enough to cut a deal internationally and then at the 11th hour try to sell it. That doesn't work. So U.S. trade negotiators, I remember Robert Strauss once commented when he was U.S. trade negotiator, that he spent more time negotiating domestically than he did internationally. What's interesting in this case was Mexico's successful courting of American domestic lobbies. Of course, they had their own domestic interests to contend with, but they actually, the Mexican government actually employed more than a dozen lobbying firms in Washington, Texas, and California to not only lobby, to better understand American domestic interests and to influence those interests, and did so with the tacit acquiescence of the Clinton administration, because the administration also needed to satisfy these domestic interests. So it's, again, a way of thinking about something that operates not only in trade negotiations, but in lots of other things. President Obama now has to sell the Iran nuclear deal domestically. So he's operating at these two levels. And the final case was an unusual one. It was the experience of the international community in delivering humanitarian aid to Afghanistan during the period of Taliban rule. It was a time when most of the donor nations didn't even have diplomatic representation in Afghanistan. Yet, somehow, the aid teams were able to develop a strategy that achieved some success. There's no way one can call this a glittering success. But in terms of the ability to mount an effort that was coordinated, we're labeling this one successful diplomacy.
And so what we're trying to do with these cases is really provide an understanding of what goes on beyond the newspaper headlines. It's the actions behind the scenes that are undertaken by a wide range of different kinds of actors. That's why we've chosen such a diverse range of cases, to see how important that is and to recognize how that has to be part of the way we think about foreign policy. We talk too much about ideology and position, not enough about the practice of what makes for effective policymaking. It's as if we judged businesses by the ideologies of their business leaders, not by what they do as businesses themselves. And the real fun part of this is actually working through these cases, and particularly the cases that we're attached to, right? Those are, of course, the most fun cases of all. And I wrote the case on U.S. opening to China. It's something I've written a lot about elsewhere. I've spent a lot of time with Henry Kissinger, writing about Henry Kissinger in the 1960s and 70s. And really what that case on China seeks to do is to unmask our misunderstandings of the opening to China. The opening to China is often depicted in one of two ways. There is the great leader approach, which says there were these few great men who realized all of a sudden that they had to bring the world together around these. And if you read Henry Kissinger's work, he pictures himself with Mao and Nixon and Zhou Enlai. And on the other side of the book, you have Metternich and Bismarck. And this is supposed to be something equivalent to that. He's not entirely wrong. But that's one way of telling that story. Another way of telling that story is saying these are two large countries, the United States and China, that for all kinds of historical reasons coming out of World War II, coming out of the experience of the communist revolutions in Russia and China, had not had relations with each other, and it was inevitably going to happen. It was inevitably going to happen, and it didn't matter who was there. I argue in the chapter on the U.S. opening to China that both of these perspectives are wrong, because one assumes that great leaders just make things happen, that if you elect the right person, all of a sudden everything will be changed and corrected. The other assumes that history moves in this impersonal way. And over time, the big powers will find a way to get along. Things will happen. In fact, neither is correct. The argument of the case and the close analysis of the U.S. opening to China and the China opening to the U.S. is that there were important risks, important efforts, and quite frankly, there were things done that were unorthodox that made a huge difference in allowing this relationship to move forward. And even though many, many people, including the person running for president, Hubert Humphrey, including many others, believed an opening to China was necessary, it would not have happened in the way it did if it were not for a number of actions taken not by great men, but by individuals in China and the US who were, quite frankly, desperate to find a way to open relations with one another. And they turned their desperation into a kind of risk-taking, almost entrepreneurship, that made this relationship at that time possible, but then, of course, created future difficulties for them. What do I mean here? I think the best way to think about the U.S. opening to China is to think about two middle schoolers. I have middle school children, so everything comes back to this, right? Two middle schoolers eyeing each other across the dance floor who don't know how to talk to one another. And the dance can go on a long time before they actually talk to one another, right? And they can come home and cry about it. That's actually what the way the U.S.-China relationship looked in 1968, 1969. These are two big societies, very close to each other in the war in Vietnam, in the sense that our soldiers and our activities are coming very close to Chinese forces, sometimes crossing into their area. We share similar adversaries in the Soviet Union and others. We have diametrically opposed interests. We have problems at home. And we're eyeing each other as major actors who have not had relations with one another since 1949. In fact, the last serious American effort to talk to the rulers of China was George Marshall's effort in 1946. Poor George Marshall, after winning World War II, he's asked to go to China and try to negotiate between Zhou Enlai and Mao Zedong, and between Chiang Kai-shek and Mao Zedong, and of course it doesn't succeed. What do Nixon and Kissinger and Mao and Zhou Enlai do? They do things that are incredibly riskful as diplomats. They're risky activities that have actually a huge effect, and that's really what the chapter is about. It's wonderful to write and read about because we have extensive documentation. We can get well beyond the memoirs now. We can look at actually what was happening. Let me give you some of the highlights, some of the parts of the story that I find most dramatic and most fun to think about. One of the first things that Nixon and Kissinger do when they come into office is they realize that they need to show the Chinese that they actually want to work with them. And so they have to make unilateral concessions. They never say this in public, but they make unilateral concessions. Concessions on lifting certain sanctions, especially on food aid, to China, which is dealing with major food problems during the Cultural Revolution. Lifting sanctions on visas, lifting sanctions on financial transactions. They do this under the radar screen of the American public, but they do it intentionally, this is in the documentation, so that the Chinese will see it. So much for the United States being strong and telling others what to do, right? They make initial concessions. And then, this is my favorite part, and you can read this, I quote the documentation on this. They are like the middle school boy who's waiting by the phone to get the call back. Did she call yet? Did she respond to my call yet? Because what they've done is they've made these initial moves, and they're looking to see how the Chinese react. They also, as happens in middle school, find all kinds of friends who are in the middle of the dance floor who can talk to the other side. So they ask the Pakistanis, they ask the Norwegians, they ask the Romanians, they ask the Poles. They ask anyone they can find who has relations with China and good relations with the U.S. to say nice things to them, to the Chinese, to open the conversation, to get the conversation going. They make all of these moves. What's interesting, and we talked about misperceptions this morning a little bit, the Chinese are doing this in their own way too. So Mao Zedong publishes Nixon's inaugural address, the first time an American president's inaugural address was published in the People's Daily, uncensored. Mao also commissions a group of four marshals to actually do an internal report on Chinese relations with the U.S., and the report is set up to actually say, well, maybe we should work with the United States. He brings Edgar Snow, an American journalist, to observe the Chinese Independence Day, Revolution Day events of 1970. He's trying to signal the United States as well. And what's interesting, again, the middle school analogy I think is quite good, the two sides misread each other's signals. They don't recognize it. They don't recognize that they like each other, right? They're not sure what's going on here. The breakthrough comes, and this is really important, the breakthrough comes when one side is willing to go beyond signaling and actually pull over, walk across the dance floor, pull someone over to their side, invite someone to them. The Chinese do this famously in 1970, inviting a group of American ping pong players. This is the famous ping pong diplomacy. The table tennis players, the ping pong players, are in Japan for the international tournament. They're invited over to China. And this is, again, why historical research is so revealing to us. You realize if you go back and look at the coverage of this, what a monumental moment that became within American society. Life magazine follows the ping pong players around, and China is normalized to some extent for Americans. The Chinese table tennis players look like the American table tennis players. They have friendly relations. China is not this crazy place. They play tennis. And you know what? They're really nice. They let our American table tennis players not lose so badly. They still lose, but not as badly as they would lose. You've seen the Chinese play ping pong, right? The effort here is actually more significant than one would think if you just put it in a diplomatic context. It's a public relations transformation. The Chinese then go forward again and invite an American emissary to come over, and Henry Kissinger makes sure that he's the person who does that. And he famously secretly visits China in July of 1971. And the story gets only more interesting as the conversations begin. Part of diplomacy, we argue in the book, is not simply getting the conversation going. It's what you do when the conversation begins. And one of the most important things you do is develop trust among those who did not have trust. For all the criticisms that can be made of Henry Kissinger, and there are many to be made, one thing Kissinger did very well throughout his career is gain the trust of powerful people he was working with. In fact, sometimes he went too far in doing this, one could argue. His success in China is because he figures out a way to do that. His meetings with Zhou Enlai in July of 1971 are not meetings where they discuss conflicting interests. They don't even talk about Taiwan. They're meetings about trying to develop mutual trust, mutual understanding. What do they talk about? They talk about how important it is to each side that these two great societies begin to talk to one another. They talk about the problems they have at home, and they talk about how much they hate the Japanese. It's always good to have someone else you hate more, right? This is, again, like middle school, right? As long as there's someone you hate more, you can get along with everyone else. That's the basis upon which the initial communique, the initial announcement of the U.S.-China opening begins. The story gets even more interesting from there because the famous Nixon visit is arranged for February of 1972. And we talked about this morning, but I can't stress this enough, how strange and how risky that visit is for both sides. Nixon goes to China in February 1972 with less preparation than President Obama will in going to Austin on Friday. There is no agenda, none at all. Richard Nixon has no guarantee he will meet with Mao Zedong. So just think about that. He could have flown all the way over there, had no meeting with Mao Zedong. What would that have looked like in February of 72 before the November election? Right? He goes with the hope, with the belief, with the trust that somehow he'll get a meeting with Mao. He has no pre-existing schedule, no promise of what he'll do, no briefing papers in advance with the agreements that are going to be made. Most summits, if you read the documentation, before they even go, they know what they're going to do. He goes over there, he arrives, met by Zhou Enlai at the airport, and then a few hours later, Zhou Enlai comes to the guest house and says, oh, now the great leader will meet with you. Come on. And Nixon and Kissinger quickly put their clothes on and go meet with Mao Zedong. They accept this. This is really important. They don't say this in their memoirs at all. What they understood was that they had to go to the Chinese, not as Western imperialists shaking their fingers. They had to go to the Chinese as the deferential barbarians coming to visit the Great Kingdom. And if you see the images of that meeting, Mao is set up as the emperor in his study. And Nixon and Kissinger are there assembled around him with Zhou Enlai in a corner listening in. What do they talk about at these meetings? Even then, they don't talk about Taiwan. They don't sit down and argue. They look for low-hanging fruit. They look for commonality. They look for common interests. They're having their first date, right? They're finding what makes sense, what they like, what food they like together, what things. They talk about the students they hate in their societies who are causing problems. They both go on rants. Pre-scripted, in a sense, right? If only the students would just understand that we're really trying to maintain peace and stop burning our campuses, Nixon says. Mao says, yes, these Red Guards, I mean, they just don't understand. They can't destroy our society in the way they are. They begin by talking about their problems at home and how they're both struggling against the same difficulties, and they can understand each other because they have the same difficulties. Then they talk about the end of World War II and how important it is to maintain order in Asia. Then they talk about the problems of the Soviet Union, which Mao says they're not a real communist society. And Nixon says they're the worst kind of communist society. We can agree on this. And then they move to areas where they can work together. They both want to increase trade. They both want to see more activity to stabilize the situation about Vietnam. They do not agree on what the solution in Vietnam should be, but they both want to see the war contained. They're worried about where the war is going. And they build a relationship along these lines. They come out of that agreement not with any major breakthrough strategically, but with an entirely different attitude between the two societies. And as a historian, I can tell you it's an attitude that quickly filters through American society. They come home and they are criticized by some people you might have heard of, William F. Buckley, Ronald Reagan, various others, Barry Goldwater. But it doesn't matter, because the momentum created by these two societies meeting and talking, the images of this, actually create a process that eventually will turn Ronald Reagan and others into advocates of this relationship. What they realize is that diplomacy fundamentally is about building relationships of personal trust that are then generalizable beyond the individuals, and relationships that gain a momentum in encouraging others to make those investments as well. They took the risks to make that happen. These were not great men. These were risk takers. That's really the point I try to make in this chapter. They were risk takers. They were willing to use diplomacy, quite frankly, because they didn't think something else would work. Nixon didn't have a military solution, and he knew it. Mao didn't have a traditional communist solution, and he knew it. So they looked to relationship building, they looked to crossing lines to build a new attitude between their societies. This also led to many failings as well. This is not a utopian story at all. This was very personalized. It was done against the institutions of their societies. Both Mao and Nixon were surrounded by people who said, this is not how you should do this. And to their credit, Mao and Nixon did not let the naysayers prevent them, but to their discredit, they never got the naysayers within their governments to buy into this process. So you had popular support, but not institutional support. In fact, Nixon and Kissinger were not effective institutional managers. They were not good CEOs. They did not make the institutions match up with what they were doing. This caused a lot of problem. It's why you have another 7 years, really, before you have the full fruition of the 1972 meeting with the actual opening of relations, and that's done by Carter and Brzezinski. They're the ones who do and deserve credit for the hard institutional work. The other problem with this was this relationship, this bipolar relationship that was built, it left a lot of other allies out. It left a lot of other allies out. As the new couple formed in the middle school, other students were not brought along. Other friends were left out of the new relationship. It hurt American relations with Japan. It hurt American relations with India. And there wasn't enough diplomacy by Nixon and Kissinger to manage those relationships. So part of the story is that they managed the diplomacy well in one area, but didn't do similar things with other allies in the region who were very important. So one of the lessons here, it's a hard lesson, is that you don't just do this in one case. It has to be about more than that. Part of the problem with Henry Kissinger's legacy, and I say this having spent a lot of time writing about him, is he has some impressive successes, but he also has some disastrous failures. And he sees the disastrous failures as exceptions. But in fact, they're hand in hand part of the same. It's because of the unevenness of the diplomacy. It's because of the unevenness of the efforts at times. And that's one of the challenges, I think, for us, is how do you figure out a way to do this not just on a case-by-case basis? How do you institutionalize? How do you normalize? How do you build it into the culture of your policy and politics that diplomacy is front and center to what you do? I think the end of the Cold War case that Bob will talk about is actually a case where, in fact, I think we had a president who probably was the best president we've had in a long time at thinking this through. And so I'll turn it over. He also had Bob Hutchings working for him, so that's obviously why.
Okay, thanks, Jeremi. I'll go over my case fairly quickly. We want to save time for the conclusions. We also especially want to save time for your questions and comments at the end. So my chapter runs about 25 pages. If that's not enough for you, I wrote a 450-page book, my memoirs, on the same period, so you can delve into that as well. So in a way, these are similar cases, because just as the opening to China was both unanticipated and then taken for granted, the end of the Cold War in Europe was one of the most astonishing events of my lifetime, certainly, that this long Cold War ended with the other side capitulating, basically, without a shot being fired. In the space of about 6 months, from midsummer of 1989 till Christmas Day 1989, when the Ceausescu regime collapsed, communist regimes, seemingly well-entrenched, all fell, one after another, in Eastern Europe. A year after that, Germany was unified. A year after that, the Soviet Union collapsed. So in the space of less than 3 years, these monumental events occurred. Yet, after the fact, it was sort of taken for granted that these were inevitable developments that were simply delivered up by history. My chapter tries to dispute that notion that these were automatic events. The Berlin Wall did not fall. It was made of steel and concrete and could have lasted another 100 years. It was chipped away as a result of political action on the ground in East Germany and West Germany, but also by the work of diplomats. And this is a case, too, of where diplomacy can be hardball diplomacy. Diplomacy can be a contact sport, too. So when George H.W. Bush took office, this is a period, Gorbachev had been in power for 4 years in the Soviet Union. Gorby mania was all over the United States and Europe. The extravagant hope that this leader was ushering in an entirely new period in global history. Yet nothing had really changed very much except atmospherically. The Soviet one-party state was still intact. None of the momentous events occurred until later. What Bush needed to do first was to give himself and his team some breathing space. First, to overcome the legacy of President Ronald Reagan, under whom Bush had served for 8 years as his vice president. For Reagan, the pith and marrow of American national security was the U.S.-Soviet relationship, and especially U.S.-Soviet strategic nuclear relations. I think had Reagan still been in office, the answer to Gorbachev would have been more nuclear discussions. Bush, in one of his first speeches as president, said, quoting, I wrote the speech, so no, quoting Václav Havel, the then Czechoslovak dissident, arms are a symptom, not a source of tension. The effort of the Bush strategy was to go to the root causes of the Cold War, which was a forcible division of Germany and of Europe. So the test that was held out to Gorbachev was to answer a series of challenges that we would hold out to the Soviet side to see if they would accept peaceful democratic change in Eastern Europe, if they would agree to massive reductions in conventional forces in Europe, 500,000 Soviet forces stationed in Eastern Europe. It was that more than another nuclear deal on the margins of security that was important. It's interesting that the strategy, when I first went to the Bush NSC in March 1989, I mentioned this morning, there's a long row of file cabinets on the third floor of the old executive office building with interesting labels on them, such as Soviet nuclear policy, Germany, and so on. All those file cabinets were empty, their contents having been packed off to the Reagan Library. This is the way our government works, to the astonishment of most other governments. So what it meant for the Bush administration was that there was no blueprint for the self-liberation of Eastern Europe. There was no roadmap to German unity. There was no file drawer labeled what to do if the Soviet Union disintegrates. We had to make up all this on the fly, as it were. I suppose, ideally, our government might have prepared for this eventuality better, but the events that made possible the end of the Cold War came so suddenly that there had not been such prior planning. So there was a great deal of strategic planning that went on in that spring of 1989, but it had to be done with great haste, and it had to evolve as circumstances evolved during the course of that year. The key insight to me that President Bush came up with, that his predecessor would not have come up with, was that the key to ending the Cold War lay where the Cold War began, in Eastern Europe, and it was there that the Cold War had to come to an end. This insight was facilitated by the Polish Roundtable Agreement of 1989, in which the opposition, led by the Solidarity Trade Union Movement, had entered into negotiations with the Polish communist regime of General Jaruzelski. promising openly contested elections that summer. And here is the judgment we made at that time. If this agreement is honored by the Polish authorities, this is the beginning of the end of communism in Poland. And if that's the case, as important as Poland is in geostrategic terms, communism is finished everywhere in Eastern Europe, including East Germany, which meant that the German question, the question of German unification, had just leapt onto the international agenda. So we were beginning to plan for, and the documentary record now shows this, because these documents have been declassified too, plan for the possibility of German unification already in the spring, 6 months before the breach of the Berlin Wall. So it was on the basis of that judgment that President Bush focused his attention on the Western Alliance and on Eastern Europe, rallying the entire NATO alliance behind the proposition that the key to European security lay in the successful transition in Eastern Europe toward democratic rule. I think it was a fundamental insight that not every administration would have made. Now, I hasten to add, no one expected this transformation to occur in 6 months. We were thinking of this as a multi-year process. And it was only after the Polish breakthrough in that summer, when solidarity in Poland scored a dramatic electoral landslide victory and was able to form a non-communist government, the first in 40 years in Eastern Europe, that we really saw that this process was coming at blazing speed. And frankly, it was at that point that I started slipping documents in the bottom drawer of my desk at the NSC, not classified documents, that would have been wrong, but unclassified stuff, because I knew I was going to write. I was sitting through something big, and I wanted to write about this because I had a perch that was almost unique. Let me just say, fast forward a little bit to the dramatic events that then happened in East Germany as protests began in East Germany, which was considered by scholars, and at that time I was a scholar of Eastern Europe, all the scholarly community considered East Germany a repressive, brutal place, but very stable, very Prussian, very, very well run, the least likely candidate for a democratic breakthrough. But there it happened, it transpired. And the breach of the Berlin Wall came with great suddenness on the night of November 9, 10 of 1989. 10 days later, we delivered to the president a strategy for German unification. It's a 10-page document that's now been declassified in full. We were doing so against the opposition of the British, French, and of course, the Soviets. The British and French were really caught off guard by this, more so than we or the Germans, and they were alarmed by the speed of the process. But I go into this in the chapter. There was actual collusion between the British and the French, and between each of those and the Soviet Union, about how to slow down the process of German coming together. So our goal was what's known in the negotiation literature as salami tactics. You slice away one opponent at a time. First, we had to neutralize British and French obstructionism. And we did that by rallying NATO around a set of principles that NATO agreed to, that so long as this process was orderly, peaceful, and a gradual step-by-step process, the Western Alliance embraced the process of the two Germanys coming together without regard to the outcome. This was enough to moderate Soviet objections a little bit and to rally the Western Alliance around a set of principles it could live with. We also felt that this step-by-step approach would make it easier to manage Soviet obstructionism. The trouble was, and I mentioned this earlier this morning, here's an example of where well-crafted policy and strategy gets overtaken by events. This strategy was rendered useless within a month because of the virtual implosion of the East German state. East Germany just collapsed. People were flooding across the border. The economy was collapsing. The Ostmark was useless. So the process was moving much more rapidly. So at the end of, during the course of January and leading up to another memo to the president at the end of January, we replaced that strategy of a gradual step-by-step approach with the faster the better. It was a 180-degree turn on the approach we propose to use on grounds that we couldn't slow this process down. And under those circumstances, we will simply ride with the flow. And if we could do this successfully, it would be harder and harder for the Soviet Union to resist. It was only after all of this that we engaged the Soviet Union directly. We didn't want to ask them whether they approved of German reunification. We already knew the answer was niet. We wanted to get to a position where it was almost impossible for them to say niet, and where it was a little easier for them to say da. Under these circumstances, we can come to live with this. So it's a case of strategy being evolved and under conditions of great flux and change. And I'll say part of the story is an effective government that Bush, because of his background, his extensive background in government and foreign policy, knew how to build a team, knew how to mobilize a vast government around a single set of overarching goals. It's also about leadership. And I'll use this to sort of segue into the conclusions we reached, because I think President George H.W. Bush exhibited leadership of a very high order. But he, like most of the other figures we studied in this book, was not a charismatic personality. He was, here's the understatement of the night, not a gifted orator. He was not a master strategist. He wasn't a commanding, charismatic personality and commanding authority figure, yet he exhibited leadership of a very high order. So this case and others caused us to dig a little deeper into what we understand to be successful leadership.
So the payoff for the book, in addition to these, I hope, rich and wonderfully interesting case studies, some of them are entertaining too, but the real payoff is the conclusion. And we put a lot of time into the conclusion. We waited till all the cases were written and rewritten and rewritten until we really sat down and tried to figure out across this wide diversity of cases, and we could come up with more, what are some of the common threads that seem to at least correlate with success? What would we take away from this? And this is the part of the book that we've been pitching to the State Department and think tanks and others. Unfortunately, they don't read as much as they should read. Unlike the Aspen audience, you guys read everything. There, they just go right to the conclusion. They're like my graduate students. They want to find the conclusion. So we came up with 10 lessons, in part because 10 is a round number, but also because we do think these are commonalities across the cases. By the way, I think these are lessons that are useful not just for international diplomats, they're useful for people involved in diplomacy in all kinds of ways. Business diplomacy, local diplomacy, maybe even family diplomacy. So I'll just go through them. Bob will chime in as well, I hope. So the first lesson, number one, success only comes from prior failures and a frank recognition of those failures. It's not just that you've failed, it's that you're honest with yourself that you've failed. Every one of these cases involves a set of policymakers, sometimes not at the top of the food chain, sometimes somewhere in the middle, who look at what happened before. Maybe it was done by someone else, so it's easier for them to do this, but nonetheless, we're very frank to themselves, not always to the public, about what had not worked. Nixon and Kissinger are a great example of this. They don't pretend that what the United States was doing in Vietnam was working. They don't get out as some wanted them to, but they don't think that what was going on before was working. Same with George H.W. Bush. He recognizes that for all the Gorby mania, as Bob was pointing out, there were a lot of things that weren't working in that relationship, or things that weren't working as well as they could have. The frank recognition of failure and the willingness to patiently build on failure is absolutely crucial. And I'll say, as a scholar who studies a lot of policymaking institutions, that's actually rare. The inclination is to call failure success and not to ask the difficult questions.
If I could just chime in here as a counter case, and I went back into government as chairman of the U.S. National Intelligence Council in 2003 to 2005, and one of my jobs was to tell truth to power. That was what I was supposed to be doing, and the truth we were trying to tell the administration was the invasion, in a military sense, went quite well. The occupation was a disastrous failure, and the insurgency in Iraq was growing, and it was deepening, and it was because of the American occupation, not some third factor that was coming in from other borders. It was, and I'm not being partisan here, but it is a very hard for administrations who go out on the limb with a risky adventure like that to acknowledge failure. And it took 2 years, 3 years, with the evidence was accumulating that this was a disaster before there was a change of course.
Absolutely. So building on that, the first point again is you have to recognize your failures and actually try to learn from them. Second, successful diplomacy involves the management of time, and that procrastination, sometimes strategically deployed, can pay off. I don't usually say that to my students because procrastination comes naturally to them. But in many of the cases, choosing the right moment was as important as choosing the right policy. And good diplomats have a sense of timing. They're not just the smartest in the room that can figure out the best thing to do. They also have a sense of when to do it. Sometimes waiting is better than not waiting. In many of our chapters, and again, George H.W. Bush is an example of this, waiting not to respond to Thatcher, letting events take their course before arguing with Maggie about those issues.
As the great political theorist Kenny Rogers said, you got to know when to hold them and know when to fold them.
Thank you. Thank you, Ambassador. Third point. This is what we might call the Eisenhower point, that planning and preparation are essential, but planning and preparation don't tell you what to do when the moment occurs. That you plan and prepare to intellectually make yourself ready. And good diplomats are constantly making those around them, on their staff, not deal with small operational issues, but ask the big questions and run through different scenarios. Think through, plan. But then when the event occurs, when the moment of truth has arrived, you don't pull the plans off the shelf. You use that intellectual capital to invent a new set of solutions. This is what I would call the artistry of diplomacy. Artists don't just start painting. They've spent a lot of time developing the skills that go into the painting that they're doing or the music that they're playing, but then they're in the moment when they're doing it. Every artist I've talked to has said that. They're then in that moment. And that's what diplomacy is. The planning and preparation are absolutely essential in preparing you for the unplanned and unprepared moment. And that's true in every one of our cases. Fourth point, one needs political leaders who value diplomacy and are willing to take risks for it. And that's surprisingly rare. In fact, it's very hard to get leaders in a strong country to do that. There are too many advantages to throw your weight around and not to take diplomatic risks. Every one of our cases, especially the non-American ones as well as the American ones, involve leaders, sometimes not again always at the top, but leaders actually investing and putting their credibility on the line. You must believe in diplomacy if you are going to be an administration that conducts diplomacy. If you run for office and say you don't like diplomacy, you will not be an effective diplomatic administration. And we as voters need to recognize that when we're choosing our leaders. Now, I thought I was careful in how I put that, right? Number five. Strategic delegation is absolutely important, and we mean delegation not just within an administration, but among allies. One must recognize the limits of one's power. One must recognize the importance of restraint. One must avoid the overreaction or the over-exaggeration of threats. Diplomacy is always undermined by the person who claims the sky is falling, and we need to react strongly with force right now. It takes a certain coolness of head, and it takes a willingness to delegate to someone else, sometimes even to delegate to another country to help, right? Delegating and restraint and recognizing the limits of power are absolutely crucial. Number six, political leaders and their agents must be aligned. It's not good enough just to be the leader at the top talking about diplomacy. You must have people in the field who you understand, who understand you, who you are working with, who you have aligned. This is a real problem in the US government. I'm not telling you anything you don't know, but as our government has grown larger and more complex, and as our international reach has grown, quite often, two sides of Washington, D.C. don't know what they're doing, let alone those in Washington, D.C. and those in Cairo and Jerusalem and anywhere else, right? Making sure there's an alignment, having the proper teamwork is absolutely crucial for the key agents. Number seven, statesmen must play two-level games. Diplomacy is always as much about domestic politics as international politics. You cannot say you want to be a great diplomat and leave the domestic politics to someone else. It's like saying you want to be a great business person and leave the profit to someone else. Right? You have to be involved as a diplomat, even if you're the ambassador of a foreign country, of thinking about how this will be sold at home. The framing, the packaging, the marketing of your issues of what you're doing is as crucial as the substance of what you're doing. That is not pablum, that is not propaganda, that is part and parcel of policy. Or another way of putting it, diplomacy is politics. Right? Clausewitz says, war is politics by other means, diplomacy is politics by other means. It's always a two-level game. The best diplomats are not imprisoned by domestic politics, but they understand domestic politics. They understand domestic politics. Number eight, there is always a careful and floating mix between secrecy and openness. Too much secrecy, in the case of Kissinger and Nixon, undermines your policies, undermines your entire presidency. Too little secrecy can make it impossible to even get the communication going. There's no simple formula. Open covenants are not enough, but closed secrecy is self-defeating. There's a mix. One needs, in a certain way, and this is a phrase that actually Bob came up with that I love, that we use in the conclusion, we must have open agreements, sometimes secretly arrived at. There must be transparency about what has happened, but not always transparency in the precise moment. Take the opening to Cuba, for example. President Obama would never have been able to do that, whether you agree with it or not. He never would have been able to do that if every day we knew what was going on. Because the opponents in a state called Florida, right, would have been up and would have done everything they could to undermine it. But now that the agreement has been made, now that we're moving forward, it's important that we understand what happened. That we can feel we buy into that, that we can feel it was done for the right reasons. So transparency is crucial. We're not arguing for secrecy, but we're arguing for a balancing of transparency and secrecy. We're arguing for discretion, for the use of discretion. When I said this to an audience a while ago, they looked and said, is there any discretion left in the United States? I'm not sure, but diplomacy requires the resuscitation of discretion. Number nine. And the number 9 and 10 are probably the two most important ones. If you don't remember anything else we said tonight, please remember these two. Number 9, diplomacy is about compromise, and it's not about one side winning and one side losing. War really isn't about one side winning and one side losing. Nothing in politics is about one side winning and one side losing. The most stable, effective actions always involve mutual gains. Everyone has to win in some way if they are going to stick by the deal. So we talked about this morning. We should be happy that the Iranians went home from Paris and said, we got something we wanted. Of course, otherwise they're not going to maintain the deal. That's the best chance we have that they're going to go along with what they agreed to. When there is, if there's another Israeli-Palestinian deal, it has to be one where both sides can claim victory. Now, not everyone wins equally. The good diplomat gets a little more for her side than the other side. But everyone has to win. We have lived under the shadow of Franklin Roosevelt's notion, right, of unconditional surrender. Unconditional surrender doesn't occur. There must be mutual gains. And diplomacy is about compromise and giving something to the other side, even if you hate the other side, as well as getting something from the other side. So I'll go out on a limb on this. I don't know if Bob agrees with this, but I'm guessing he does. We need to actually find a way to give something to the terrorists if we're going to negotiate with them. I hate terrorism. I want to eliminate terrorism wherever it exists. But we're not going to be able to do it by force alone. And those who are terrorists, we have to convince them to do something else. We have to give them something, as well as trying to just destroy them, right? Even in that case of horrible actors, right? Diplomacy is about compromise. Number 10, final point, the most important point. History doesn't repeat itself. Our cases are not designed to say what we did in China is what we should do in Iran, or that we should have another Bandung conference, or that we need to do what we did in 1990 with Vladimir Putin today in Russia. That is not the point of these cases. History does not repeat itself. But here's the really important point. There are patterns, there are tendencies, there are attitudes, and we can learn a lot from them. You cannot be an effective diplomat if you come into a circumstance and you don't understand what preceded it. You don't understand the memories. You don't understand the assumptions. You don't understand the things that the other players bring to the table. Historical understanding doesn't just give you facts. It gives you the perspective to understand and anticipate your partners in a diplomatic agreement. And so the history is not telling you what will happen, but it's telling you who you are dealing with. It's telling you who you are dealing with. So to make this very concrete, anyone who's interested in doing any work with China, you better understand the ways in which the Chinese have experienced foreign imperialism for 2 to 3 centuries, how they view that experience, how that history has played out in their society, because even if you are not the least bit imperialist, that affects the way they see you and the way they interact with you. If you're working with Iran, you must understand something about the 1953 coup. Every Iranian I've ever talked to brings that up. Every single one, even the most pro-American Iranians. That is part of their history. That is part of who they are. So historical analysis doesn't give us a roadmap, but it gives us the foundation for beginning the partnership and trust building that's crucial to diplomacy. And in a certain way, I'll just close on this somewhat polemical point, our unwillingness to teach history as a society is more than anything else what's crippling our diplomacy. Because we go around the world and we don't speak the languages and understand the people we're dealing with. We have the football coach teaching people how to think about history. And then we're surprised that we're going out and trying to tackle people rather than making the world a better place, right?
So we would be very glad to hear your questions, comments, rebuttals. Microphone's coming right behind you.
In light of what you all have just said in the summary of those 10 lessons, Syria, which you just sort of not so obliquely referred to, might be the first possibility for ISIS to be at a table to might possibly talk about something other than what they've been doing the last 4 or 5 years. With those lessons in mind, what are your all's recommendations about what's evolving very slowly, tentatively? Is it just something between the U.S. and Russia alone, or is there something that really could be for real in this?
Well, this is a case where some of the case studies in this book actually help us to the beginning of understanding. Any arrangement that comes out of this part of the world has to be one that has the contribution of Saudi Arabia, Iran, Israel, United States, Europe, Russia. I'm sure I've left out several others, Turkey, many other regional actors. Having a commonality of interest among these people is absolutely impossible. But having enough commonality to achieve certain ends with accommodating interests of those who have who are seeking things you don't agree with is going to be part of the solution. And the campaign rhetoric about defeating ISIS to me is just mindless. What does that even mean? I suppose that if we really wanted to, I'm sure, if we wanted to, we could obliterate ISIS militarily. But then what? Then what transpires on that piece of real estate that is ungoverned? What happens is something that looks pretty much like ISIS, or maybe even worse, if that's possible. So I think understanding that this is going to be a negotiated outcome of some kind, and that the best chance we have is forging the broadest possible effective coalition of countries that share enough interest to get that job done.
Yeah, I agree. I think it's a very good way of putting it. The only thing I'll add is to recognize that the use of drone strikes and things of that sort, that's actually part of a negotiation. That's not a solution. Because we can kill, and they'll just keep making more. That's been the story of the last 15 years, right? We're on a treadmill, right? And what'll happen is we'll just keep killing, they'll keep making more. But we can threaten those who we're trying to negotiate with that if they don't work with us, they might be more susceptible themselves to that kind of force. And so it has to be a negotiation. It has to include Assad. I think Bashar Assad is a horrible person, But I don't see how we move forward without including Assad. I don't see how we move forward without including the Russians. And I think if we recognize that Syria does not exist anymore, but that there are potentially different actors that could maintain authority in different areas, and we begin from there, I think we could have something that would look a lot better than what we have now. But let's also be realistic and say it's not going to be anything like the kind of solution we'd want to see. But we don't have the power to make that happen.
I saw that hand first, then there.
A similar question that Bill just raised, but a different country. What sort of lessons can be learned from the historical opening of China? And also, what guidelines do your 10 conclusions give us to begin to address the North Korean problem? Should unilateral concessions be made, as were made in China? Should we really be increasing the sanctions? Does Dennis Rodman have to go back, like the ping pong team? What can be done? What is your solution to dealing with North Korea?
Great question. So this is actually something that Henry Kissinger and I have argued about, because I said to him for a number of years, if you were, stop criticizing Obama on Iran, because if you were Secretary of State, this is the first thing you would do right now, is try to open relations with Iran. And I think that's right. So I think the lesson from China is actually a lesson that applies to places like Iran. What's similar? China and Iran are both large, complex societies that had, in 1972 in China's case, in Iran today, have horrible governments, but also are not completely controlled by those governments, where there's a lot of other things happening, right? And there are a lot of reasons to believe that an opening of relations could empower, not necessarily, but we hope, empower certain other kinds of behavior that we'd want to see. I think the same thing is true with Cuba. North Korea, I think, is different. It's hard to see any civil society left in North Korea. I think the lesson from the opening to China with regard to North Korea is that we have to find a way to work more closely with the Chinese to help us in North Korea. That's where the real solution is. The Chinese still provide energy. They keep the lights on in North Korea. They still provide some of the key food, and they're still a main trading partner with North Korea. The Chinese have not put more pressure, though they've done it a little more recently, because they're afraid of two things. They're afraid of a collapse of North Korea, which creates a refugee crisis for them. And they're afraid that they'll wake up one morning and there'll be American bases on the Yalu River. This is the same thing they were afraid about in October 1950. And so we need to reassure them that that's not what we want to do. And we need to work harder with them, and I don't think the Obama administration has worked hard enough, to get them to help much more than they are helping there. What's making that happen is not our good diplomacy, I think. It's the continual misbehavior of the North Koreans, which is, I think, the Chinese are getting more and more fed up with that. So diplomatic lessons apply in different ways to these two areas, it seems to me.
Yeah, I would just add that we're not the key diplomatic actor from North Korea's perspective. We're important in the six-party talks because we're a key player in the nuclear negotiations. But the sort of the logic that you were proposing or suggesting might be considered really applies to China and South Korea, both of whom have made unilateral concessions and continue to make unilateral concessions to North Korea in the hopes that that might evoke a response. At the moment, the so-called sunshine policy from South Korea to the North has been pretty thoroughly discredited, but it will come back. There'll be another moment in which there seems to be, from the South Korean perspective, which is the most important one, there seems to be some possibility of an opening in the North, and I am pretty confident that South Korea will make a unilateral concession to see if there's any response from the other side. There was a question right there, and then... I'm sorry, the microphone's behind you. Go ahead and ask the question, then we'll get the microphone to you. Sorry,
okay.
Sir.
Thank you. The recent display in Iran of setting off missiles, it seems to me that that's a place where we have to understand what's going on in their society, and that instead of jumping on the fact that we negotiated, we're working towards negotiating an agreement with them, we have to understand that they also have to respond to the people in their society and get them on board. And so setting off the missiles is a way for them to do that. What do you think about it?
Yeah, I think so. And I think we should be reasonably relaxed about that little show of defiance and force, which was mainly for domestic consumption. If it gets more serious, then we get more serious about it as well. I think this is another case where, as Jeremi pointed out earlier, we pay a pretty heavy price for our lack of diplomatic relations because we're flying blind in Iran in a lot of ways. We're not totally flying blind. There are people that have some knowledge of Iran, but we're not nearly as capable as the French, especially the Germans and some others, who've had diplomatic relations all these years, people on the ground who are knowledgeable. We, at the Austin Forum that I mentioned in my opening remarks, we had four European diplomats who served in Tehran, and their stories were eye-opening. The Americans were on the, including these two Americans, were on the edges of their seats, learning things about Iran that we don't have firsthand from our own sources.
And they have not, there's no evidence they have yet violated the agreement. They have kept their agreement. And so what they've done with the missile launch is totally within the agreement, and there's every reason to believe they would have done it without the agreement. So this, in a sense, it's not germane to the nuclear issue that we've been negotiating, just as people jumping up and down in the Senate is not germane to it either.
Yeah, I just one more thought on this. I think we need to keep our eye on the ball there. In my estimation, this is a good agreement. It's a culmination of years of effort from Republican and Democratic administrations alike. The terms of this agreement oblige Iran never to build a nuclear weapon. That's the agreement they signed on to. And there's pretty severe compliance monitoring that they've agreed to. Not perfect, but pretty severe compliance that they've agreed to. If they violate that, then we're back to square one. Then we reimpose sanctions and work on them again. But we've got a deal that so far they've not only failed to violate, they've actually been implementing and building down nuclear warheads or the nuclear capacity for warheads since the agreement was initialed.
So this gentleman.
Yes, right here.
Oh, only one more.
Oh, well. No, there you go.
Cool. As a Kissinger historian, I'm curious about your take on Bernie Sanders' impression of Kissinger's legacy.
I loved when Bernie Sanders brought Kissinger into the debate. I thought that was wonderful. I Bob has heard me talk about this too many times. I just find it amazing that this 93-year-old man becomes the central oracle for how we talk about foreign policy. Every candidate needs to be seen with him. He was in Dallas, and this was now about a year ago, and I went to the event, and he had, you know, all the leading business figures in Dallas sitting there, like listening to him, like the old E.F. Hutton ad, like this, as he was sitting up there drooling as, a 93-year-old man would. And then he was talking about fracking, and he knows nothing about fracking. I know nothing about fracking. He said, but yet when he says it, it becomes interesting and important for people. I think that says something about the vacuum of serious thought about foreign policy in our society for a long time, that we're relying on this 93-year-old figure as our oracle. I thought what Bernie Sanders did very effectively was he used Kissinger as symbolic capital, right? For those who support Bernie Sanders and for where he comes from politically, what Kissinger represents is the overuse of American power and the obnoxiousness of American power in a self-defeating way. And they draw a line from Vietnam to Iraq, that argument. And I thought he used that very effectively. I think that's not an entirely fair reading of Kissinger, but it's not an entirely unfair reading either. Bernie Sanders is right on 2 points and wrong on 2 points, I guess I would say. The 2 points he's right on is that Kissinger has a hard time, a very hard time, understanding how other societies have experienced his realpolitik in ways that do not accord with his priority values. And second, he has a very hard time recognizing that the use of American power can often be self-defeating, even when it solves a short-term problem. So those are two areas. Where I think Bernie Sanders is wrong is that Kissinger has a point about the United States having a strong interest in creating international order. I don't think we should be going around the world intervening in the way we've been doing the last 10 to 15 years militarily. It just hasn't worked. But I don't think not intervening works either. Right? The joke around Washington, right, is that we intervened in Iraq and it was a mess. So then we didn't intervene in Syria, and it was a mess. And then we did kind of halfway in Libya, and it was a mess. So what I respect about Kissinger is his willingness to try to think through how the United States can use its power to build order. We have to contribute to a more orderly world. We have every reason for our environmental sustenance, for everything else. And he's right about that. And second, I think he is right about the importance of the United States setting priorities. One of the criticisms of Kissinger is that he has a very hierarchical view of the world. That doesn't match with the human rights instincts we have. But I do think we have to set priorities as a country. So it was effective what Bernie Sanders did, but of course it was a partial view of Kissinger. But I loved it. I loved that it brought history in.
Let me just add a word about Kissinger, because Kissinger's influence on American diplomacy has been enormous. It's sort of like 6 degrees of Kevin Bacon. There's 6 degrees of Henry Kissinger. The number of people who worked directly for Kissinger, or who worked for people who worked for Kissinger, is just enormous. I'm one of the latter camp. Brent Scowcroft was very close to Kissinger. I worked for Scowcroft, as did Condi Rice. The Obama administration is really the first one we've had that wasn't dominated by foreign policy thinkers whose thinking and strategic mindset was affected profoundly by Kissinger. That's not to say that his solutions to global problems was always right. In the period of my chapter, he was wrong on Eastern Europe. He advocated an understanding between the United States and Moscow on the limits of change in Eastern Europe. He thought that was being a realist with a capital R. My view, that was extremely unrealistic, because the would-be reformers and revolutionaries in Eastern Europe were not going to await the convenience of the two superpowers. So what was trotted out as a realistic position really wasn't so. But what we miss is that strategic mindset of understanding that what happens in one part of the world has ripple effects in other parts of the world, that one always needs to think about the second and third order effects of a foreign policy action and take the long view. We miss that in our government now.